Who is familiar with the cubes concept and OLAP? Yeah. Nice. Okay, so I'm going to talk about cubes, the Python lightweight framework for multidimensional modeling and actually building the cubes. And I have lots of stuff to go through, so it's going to be kind of like lightning talk, but a little bit longer. I'm not going to dive into too much details. If you have questions, then we can look at particular feature of cubes. So most of the talks here are about data analysis. This is going to be more about the understanding of the data, which actually the whole concept of the cubes and multidimensional modeling usually is about. For those who haven't seen cubes before, its main purpose is to build reporting apps or the modules for reporting apps that are based on a metadata model and for aggregation of the data. So it's very simplified explanation of cubes is a mapping between the logical view of the data to a physical storage of the data. And the kind of data it works the best is the categorical data. It's basically aggregation based on categories. So it started as an OLAP framework. I rather call it a conceptual modeling and analytics framework. So the original cubes before 1.0 was released in September. It was really simple framework which had just one model, one data store, one database, and one workspace per process or per server. So we wanted to have a multiple databases. You have to launch multiple servers or multiple processes to access all those different databases. And you would have to fit everything into one model. So, and we need more. So, cubes was redesigned because you might have model even like written in a file stored somewhere, or the model can be stored in a database, or there are already services that have these concept of cubes, and why not use them? Why not just read their metadata and translate it to our view of the cubes model and to our perception of dimensions from that store? And also, on the other hand, on the bottom, on the store side, you might have different databases. You might even get the data from an API, and you would like to present it to the users, so users do not need to know where the data comes from. And the data are already expected to be formatted in a certain usable way. So here comes the cubes 1.0. Finally, it's Python 3. Cubes still supports the Python 2.7 for the 2 series, but the main focus is going to be on Python 3. And here's the highlight of the features I'm going to talk about. So first is analytical workspace, model providers, how the new backend for the cubes looks like, how it accesses data, how we can extend the cubes, and things like authentication and authorization. So the analytical workspace is the biggest change in cubes, and this is the place where you bind together all your storage and all your parts of your data warehouse together in one space, one workspace. So in this example, we have 4 cubes, 2 different databases, 1 cube coming from external source, and that source also provides the model. So we are not specifying the model, we just read the model from this external source. For example, from the mix panel, we just read the properties of the cube from the mix panel and present it as a cubes. And users do not have to know that it actually comes from different stores. Here's an example how you configure such an environment. So you specify the list of the models, you specify the databases, the connections, and the cubes framework does the rest. It maps those models to particular data stores and retrieves the data from that store. And well, yeah, you can bring your own either beer or backend. And new cubes supports all the SQL databases that the SQL Alchemy supports. SQL Alchemy is actually a really awesome framework. If you do not know about that, definitely recommend if you are working with relational databases. And this is just a few of them listed. I think there are like around 10, and also others as external models for the SQL Alchemy. The new backends for Cubes in Cubes 1.0 is the backend for the MongoDB, for Mixpanel, for Google Analytics, to also to demonstrate how you are getting the external models for Cubes. And of course, Cubes can connect to itself. So if you have different instances running over there, like, or if you'd like to present just few Cubes for an open data server on your, for your users, you just connect to a Cubes running in a different place and present it as a part of your collection of Cubes. So what is the new backend of Cubes? There are three kinds of objects in the backend, and it's the model provider, the aggregation browser, and the data store. I'm going to explain all three. So model provider, well, provides the model, either from the file or from external source, browse does the aggregations, and store is connecting to the database. So let's have a look at the model provider in more details. And I'm going to use Google Analytics as an example, because really nice example to demonstrate how the model provider works. So if you are familiar with Google Analytics, they have an API, and they also have a metadata API. So you can already retrieve the metadata about the metrics inside, and you can get the dimensions, you can get the metrics, and we are just going to translate them to our way of modeling the cubes. So we load the data from the Google API and create this illusion of cubes on our side. So model provider creates the metadata on the fly. We do not even have to have the specified the list of the cubes before we run the server. Every time we are trying to get the data, we get the list of cubes that's available for the user at that point of querying on the server or external source. Here's just an example of mapping of the concepts. So for example, in cubes, the fact is usually mapped to a table, dimension approximately to a column, might be multiple columns. And well, obviously you need to define the model, because you do not have enough of metadata in a SQL in a relational database to understand that. You can try to derive it, but not always sufficient. In MongoDB, the cubes is usually a collection. And here you can also see the Google Analytics, where we are mapping the metric to a cube. So for Google Analytics, in our case, we have one cube per metric, or illusion of a cube per metric, and dimensions stay dimensions. So what are the model improvements in Cubes 1.0? These are the basic three ones. First, we have additional metadata, and we split the measures and aggregates. So aggregates are no longer generated implicitly from the list of measures. You define them explicitly. I will show you how. And more front-end metadata to be usable by the reporting apps. And you can link the dimensions within the context of the cube. Also, I'm going to show it. So the measure is the property is the numerical property of the fact, and aggregate is aggregated measure. So there are like two separate pieces of metadata also in our model. And this is how we define it in the model. So no, as I mentioned before, the aggregate names are no longer generated, so your front end doesn't have to guess like, oh, is it going to be called this way or that way? You can use the name whatever you want, and it also solves the problem of custom labels for the aggregates. Yeah. So the custom name can also refer to other aggregates. You can even do the computations on top of aggregates. Once the aggregates are retrieved from the database, you can use other post-aggregation functions to get different you can use post-aggregation functions. So contextual dimensions, it's you are linking a dimension to a cube based on a context. So you might have a cube where the granularity of a dimension, for example, the time, might not be on an hourly basis or a daily basis, but your time dimension is on an hourly basis, and your fact table or fact table, your cube, is on a monthly basis. So you just link the dimension that already exists, but you say, oh, but I just want on the level, on the month level, to link, I just want to link this dimension on a month level. There are more properties that you can specify for that particular context in the cubes. More front-end and back-end also related metadata are dimension roles, so you can specify what role is this dimension. Currently, there is only one role, it's a time, and you specify the level, which is like year, month, day, or week. And then front-ends can display the most appropriate user interface for that dimension, and also back-ends can work with that property in a special way if they know how to deal with that. Another piece of metadata is cardinality, so you can specify the dimension cardinality or a level cardinality, which is also used on the both sides. It's used on the front-end side and on the back-end side. On the front-end side, you are usually using it to know what kind of user interface you are going to display for that dimension or for that level. So if the dimension is of a high cardinality, you're not going to display all the values because you can kill your web browser. So you just use some search field or something simpler to display that. If it's tiny cardinality, you just display bunch of checkboxes. And on the backend side, it's kind of like prevention for users to kill your database. So if they are trying to drill down through a high cardinality dimension, you can just say, no, I'm not going to do that because I'm going to just spit lots of data. You have to add like additional conditions, filters to that query, and then I'm going to answer. So it's also kind of like protection. The browser, so this is the core which does the aggregations or delegates the aggregations to another external system. So the browser uses the model to understand how the browser should generate the queries or how it should delegate the generation of queries to other systems and gets the data and provides the data to the user. Here are the basic browser methods. Pretty much the same. You can aggregate, get the members of the dimension, get the facts, get the one particular fact, you can get the cell details. Cell details are mostly used for the front ends to generate these, I call them multi-dimensional breadcrumbs, where users see, oh, this is where I'm actually looking at. I'm looking at this year and this customer. And the new method is features. It's just a metadata method that will return what this browser is able to provide, what kind of functionality this browser is providing for this cube you are asking for. Because different backends might provide different functionality, and some backends, for example, do not have the facts, do not have the details, they just provide aggregates. But I would like to know what I can get for this cube for this backend. So this is the method. This is what this method is used for. Another nice feature is a split cell. It's kind of artificial dimension that it's being generated on a query time. And example use of the split cell, I'm looking at the year, for example, year of 2014, and I would like to compare first half of the year and second half of the year. So I define the split cell as a first half of the year, and then I will get the result split into two parts, the first part of the year and the second part of the year, also using my contextual cell. So it's artificially generated dimensions based on the query. Might not work on all the backends. It's implemented into the SQL backend. So SQL backend, you can use that. Yeah, so I was mentioning the post aggregation. Once you get the aggregates, they're mostly useful for time series. So when you're drilling down by dates, any level, you can use the post aggregation functions. The store, there's not that much to talk about the store. It's really simple, doesn't provide yet that much functionality. Mostly provides the connection, and multiple browsers can share one connections with the store. It can communicate to external APIs. In the future, it might provide functionality like validation. It can generate schemas might provide optimization, but not yet. But it was made a separate part of object. So this is my favorite part, is the SQL backend, or known as relational OLAP, or SQL query generator in kubes. So this is built-in backend in kubes. It comes with kubes already. When you install kubes, you get a SQL backend. Well, you get a Mongo backend as well, but this is the most developed one. So what's new in SQL backend? There is a new query builder, join optimization, support for outer joins, which was slightly tricky, but we did it. Support for the split dimension, as I was mentioning, and new aggregate functions. So let's have a look at the join optimization. So if you are querying really big Snowflake schema, the kubes is not denormalizing the whole Snowflake schema and then applying your drill downs or your cell conditions. It figures out what attributes from which tables are being used for that particular query for that Snowflake, and it just joins the table that are necessary for that query you are asking, which is, I think, nice, because the less joins you are having, the faster you can get your answer. So it analyzes the query, selects the tables, and creates the joins. He had outer joins. So originally, kubes did just an inner join. So you had to have the records also in the fact table and in dimension tables. What was added are the outer joins. So for example, if you are joining the time dimension, you can get the values, the members from time dimension that don't necessarily have to have the facts in the fact table. So this is called a detail, which is one way. And another way was added, it's not recommended to use it, but the second case is where you are counting all the facts, all the rows in the fact table, and for which you don't necessarily have to have dimension members. It's not recommended because you should have your dimension cleaned up. You should have at least the values for the unknown or missing values in there. But since kubes, the target of your kubes, are also simpler users and not that cleaned up databases, we also provide this feature. I mean, why not? You can clean up later. Meanwhile, you can use this feature. Another feature added is authentication and authorization. There are some cases, mostly in businesses, where we would like to restrict the access to the kubes, where we would like to restrict, for example, access for a manager to a particular stored data, or you would like to for agents to see only his data in the kubes. And you can limit it by adding these rules, who can access what portion of the cube, or which cubes what person can access. So authentication is built in a slice server. It's highly extensible. That is just a very simple authenticator in a server. And authorization is built in a workspace. So when you're querying the workspace, it asks the authorizer, hey, can I query this cube? And if the authorizer says, yes, you can query this cube, but you have to add these additional conditions for this user, it will just add the conditions, will return the modified cell, and you just fire that query to the browser. It is just an example of a simple built-in authentication, nothing sophisticated. If you would like to something more sophisticated or store the data in a database, you can. This is just a simple file-based authentication here. How you configure it, you just say, use this simple, and the writes are in the writes file. You can build your own like LDAP authentication and authorization. Like both modules can be customized. And this is my second favorite part, is the slicer server, which was rebuilt using Flask. And you will see the advantage of using Flask in this case. The model queries were changed. There is no longer whole model query, because as I was mentioning all these external sources, it might take forever to retrieve all the cubes for the external sources. You might have like 60 cubes in Mixpanel because you have 60 different kinds of events on Mixpanel. And you do not want users to wait that long to retrieve all these information from Mixpanel. So you are just getting the brief list of cubes, which is just a name, a label, and basic stuff you can display in your selection box for the cubes. And then if you'd like to know the more details, the structure of the dimensions, then you query the particular model for that cube. When user selects the cube, you just get the whole description. So this is the reason why the model was dropped from the API of the cubes. The queries, they are still the same. So we have the aggregate members, fact, and cell for the multidimensional breadcrumbs. It looks still the same, that nothing changed. All the couple of features were added. So I was talking about the split dimension. It was also added. And the aggregation is the same. The member is the same. So the server, basically the same. You have to, but you have to always specify explicitly the cube and cube name in the query. The response is also the same, slightly richer, might contain more information. You can look it up in the documentation what kind of information is included in the response. Just to mention, it also, you don't necessarily have to have the keys of dimension as a numbers or as an identifier as it was before. Now you can have whatever you want. You can query any column because you can just simply escape the columns in a query. This is a nice feature for the end users and also for the front ends. This was added. You can specify the relative time, so you can say, "Hey, give me the just like last 3 months or 90 days ago until today." And this is where the server is using the role of the dimension. So you have the role a time, then it can use these pieces of information. It's nothing sophisticated. It's not like complicated language parsing. Is really simple grammar, but it serves its purpose for the most of the cases that people need that. So just a couple of months, days, or whatever granularity you would like to go back or forward. Another thing that was added, more output formats. So you get a CSV, JSON, and JSON lines, which is like line delimited JSON for the facts and the members. And it also for the aggregation. It's not there yet, but the JSON lines will be added also for aggregation. So this is one of the reasons why it was also migrated to Flask. It's the way of deployment, how you can deploy the cubes. So a couple of yoga positions here. I'm not going into details on all of these. Just you can see that there are many ways how to deploy the cubes. So for example, you can have a slice a server running and you write your application just in HTML and JavaScript and communicate through the JSON with the server. Or there are a couple of open data instances which are implemented in a way, as you can see on the right side, right top side, where is a slice a server running and you have your app in whatever language you want. You just connect to the server and display the data. And you can also integrate the cubes in your application. So if your application is written in a Django, you just call direct. You don't even have to use the slicer. You just call directly the cubes methods. Or if your app is written in Flask and you would like to provide like raw analytical data API, you can use this nice feature, is a Flask blueprint. So you just use the cubes blueprint and you will get the raw analytical API for free, basically, for your app. Immediately, you just specify the route where it's going to be routed. So the front ends, a bunch of new front ends were added. Generic browsing front ends for the data were added to the cubes or developed. Here is one really nice one built by Robin Thomas and Ryan Berlew, and this one is also included in the cubes repo. You specify the URL of your cube server. And the front end is pure JavaScript and HTML. It connects to the server, talks a little bit with the server, like what are the cubes, what are the models, and then presents to the user list of the cubes in categories. Oh, I didn't mention the categories. You can also categorize the cubes. It's a simple thing, but for the user, it's really important if you have so many cubes. So you don't want the users to get lost in your number of cubes. They specify how they would like to drill it down, and this is how it looks like. Then you can select the graph. This application is mostly for time series data, so it's time series oriented. Browsing application, it can connect to any 1.0 server, so if you're running, you would like to see the data, you just connect with this app to the server, and you are ready to run your reports before you develop your own, or if you are satisfied with this one, which is actually really nice, and you can do lots of stuff. You can change the chart type, you can change the filters, really nice the filter. It has really nice daytime filter, also using the dimension roles. If you have a dimension role, which is a date, you can get nice calendar browser. So this is another one, again, you specify the cube server, the location, and you connect to through another app. This one is CubeViewer, developed by Jose Juan Montes. You can get it on GitHub. It has slightly different approach. It's more category oriented. You can generate multiple reports. It has this concept of panels where you see the flow of your thought process during the reporting. You can display the tables. You can display the charts, and it's also pure JavaScript and HTML. But it also has a Django backend, what you can use to save your reports, share with other users. And so on. So another nice generic reporting app built on top of cubes. And there was a new app released just a couple months ago. It's not generic, but just to show you what you can also do with cubes is to create an app for specific kind of reporting. And this is an open data portal, Czech Germany, and front-end developed by Felix Ebert and data scraped and processed by one of the leading open data experts, Friedrich Lindeberg. You can get all the sources online. But just to show you, this is another kind of application you can build on top of cubes. Really, it's just by the end of October or early November. So to sum it up, the new cubes 1.0 offers the heterogeneous pluggable environment. It's much easier to extend to write your own backends, write your own model providers or browsers. And the SQL query generator was hugely improved. Lots of stuff I didn't mention. I didn't mention localization, how we can localize the cubes and the metadata, namespaces, or even like query logging. And I also didn't mention the incubated features that are already in the cubes, but are not yet developed in a way that can be used by anyone. But they are already there for the brain ones. They can use them. It's like non-additive properties of a cube. And there is also included the modeler app. It's a JavaScript app which allows you to model the cubes. It needs more development. And cubes.js, which is a JavaScript library that connects to the cube server, it also needs a little bit of more development to be used. And what's the future is I would like to include arithmetic expressions in your model that will be translated to either SQL or any other backend you are using. Better SQL improvements, and I would like to use a couple of Postgres features, so if you are using Postgres, you can benefit even more by using the cubes, and slightly even better API, so it would be even easier to create a custom browser. Well, and of course, cubes.js, but my capabilities JavaScript is not that good, so if anyone knows JavaScript, he is welcome to talk to me. And yeah, I just, with the help of Robin, we created this simple JavaScript library, but it needs to be improved. So cubes was never meant to compete with big data all up solutions, and I would like to keep it this way. I would like to keep the cubes still lightweight, so anyone can use it without like 10 engineers. Anyone can just like spin off instance of cubes on top of their not always well modeled database and be ready to run and build a front use those reporting apps on top of it. If you would like to contribute or use let me know. There is lots of stuff to improve. It grew quite a bit, so it's much larger library, but still trying to be lightweight. Couple of credits here. So many thanks for having this 1.0 done and released to Robin Thomas, who developed quite a lot of features, including Mongo backend, Ryan Berlew, who was working on the Cubes visualizer, Jose Juan Montes with his feedback and improvements to Cubes, and his viewer and Squarespace, which contributed with the open source release, the open source of their contributions to Cubes. And thanks also to all the contributors and people who commented on GitHub. So thank you, and if you have any questions. Between a tool that...
Well, the data visualizer from InSQL Server and your tool.
InSQL, I haven't used that one in SQL Server.
Using
Bits.
Using? Business intelligence.
Mm-hmm.
You can visualize the data and do slicing, dicing.
Yeah, so this is actually this tool. For it's open source kind of tool for doing that. Well, first, this is open source, so anyone can use it. You can use it not only on like SQL Server, you can use it on MySQL, on Postgres, on Mongo, or like on anything. And it's well, it's affordable. People in world of open data can use it. They don't necessarily have to like buy into huge BI solutions to be able to have the features from the high-end BI solutions, which most of the people don't even need that much. They do not even need that huge performance. They just need to have their small database running, but have these nice feature in there. So advantage is being lightweight and being able to connect to any homemade databases.
Can I join my Google Analytics data with my storage data?
No, it has to be separate. So in this case, it's not computational engine, it's not like the whole data warehouse solution, it's not doing data integration. It's just this Cubes part that Cubes are being presented to the users. So it's not a data integration solution. If you would like to mix the data together, you will have to either do it in a separate tool or a different way, or in your data warehouse. So it's, yeah.
So, sorry if you already mentioned this, the two cap blueprints, so some of my data lives on a graph database.
Oh, graph database.
Yeah, can support any of those guys yet?
No graph database. But I would like to be interested in the description of the problem, just curious, so we can talk later. What is the kind of problem? Thank you.